Hey everyone, happy Wednesday. I do a lot on Fridays, so my life is just a little bit different today. I am so excited to have Dr. Karen with me today. Dr. Karen and I have been buddies for, way back to the 2X plus one time. The first one we met at was in Las Vegas. That was a long time ago. But at any rate, So Dr. Karen and I have known each other a really long time. She is a master at chiropractic and pregnancy and has written a book and developed the Gardner method. And so we're just going to take off and get rocking and rolling. We have a lot to cover today. I know that there's so many chiropractors, male and female, males and females, who love adjusting pregnant women. And I think it's a great niche to be in. I just want to remind you, we want your questions. We want your feedback. We want your comments. So please put them below. When you do, if you do not want them to pop up, then remember to message me on Facebook so that I can, somebody just asked how they can get to our interview. Well, I hope they figure it out because I can't switch off. So
no.
I hope you make it, Dr. Jennifer. At any rate, so let's just get started. So we want to, so Dr. Karen and I both received questions from individuals, whether it was through the, I'm not sure why that's not showing. Ooh, weird. Okay, it's going to pop up now, I think. Through the Women Chiropractors Facebook group, I want to encourage all of you, if you are not in the Women Chiropractors Facebook group, I highly, highly, highly recommend that you join the Women Chiropractors Facebook group because it is a phenomenal group to be connected to other women and to just really and truly get questions answered and so please join. I'm not sure why our names aren't coming up there, but just a second.
Names are showing on my screen, Barb.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
It's there.
And are you seeing, I just clicked right now to the best chiropractic training and education material?
Yeah, it's all there.
Okay. It's not shown on my, but that's fine. All right, so let's just start, Karen. Like, how'd you get here? Why pregnancy? Tell us real quickly about your chiropractic journey for those who don't.
I will try to keep it short, but it's kind of a convoluted journey. The first thing happened when I was in chiropractic school, back when Life University was just Life. I was in eighth quarter, which is the very first quarter you can see outpatients. And my first patient was pregnant. And I was clueless. Oh my God, there's a pregnant lady. I don't know what to do. So I felt very insecure and uncertain about what to do. I know it has to be different, but what's different? So at Life at the time, I don't know how it is now, but at the time, we did not have our pediatrics or pregnancy course until 12th quarter. That was a whole year away. I'm like, this lady's not going to be pregnant in a year. I need to know this stuff now. So I just started researching on my own the mechanisms of the pregnant pelvis and the ligaments that attach to it and blah, blah, blah. And not to make light of blah, 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 but, there's a lot to learn. And when I finally did get to my prenatal class in chiropractic school, I was really disappointed. I didn't get the information that I thought I wanted. So I just kept that journey going and going. And when I was in practice in 1996, I started my first practice with my ex-husband, and I found out I was pregnant the very same month we started our practice. So by going to the midwife during that pregnancy, I started to develop a relationship with her, and then I got some great information and great referral sources from her, and that's how it kind of all started. So the teaching and the books and everything that I've done came about after I was attacked by the quack busters practicing obstetrics without a license. So that kind of lit a fire under my rear end. And I said, you know what, I'm going to teach other people to do what I do and let them come after all of us. So that's kind of where I am now. And I see that someone said that pregchiro.com isn't working. It was working 10 minutes before I got on live today. So maybe just make sure you put the www.brightcairo.com and see if that works. But I know the website is up and running.
Yeah. So Paula, if that doesn't work, I'll also like pop up Dr. Karen's email address and you can always get in touch with her that way. So let's talk about the Quackbusters for a second. So you mean life has just been smooth sailing from the time you graduated and it's just been roses?
Oh yeah. Of course it's been roses. No, it's been a bumpy ride. And I'm glad to say you've been with me for much of that bumpy ride, my friend. You know what I'm talking about. No, but I had to reinvent myself. I had to start all over again from nothing. I got divorced about 6 years ago. Seven years ago was the whole process starting. So I lost my practice in that divorce. So, because my ex-husband is also a chiropractor, so he kept the practice, I kept the house. So I had to start all over again. So, you know, building a practice, getting referrals, getting your name out there. I had a new name now, so I had to rebrand myself. And it was very humbling, but also kind of exciting that I got to do it all over again. So, bumpy is one way to explain.
Yeah. And, you know, I think it's just, it's not only been personal things, but like Quackbusters and even, you know, the haters within our profession.
Oh yeah.
Didn't really want you stepping on their toes or, you know, like threatening the throne if you were. So let's talk for a second about, how have you overcome that stuff? I mean, Quackbusters is a pretty big gig and even like the powers that be within our profession, what kept you focused to keep moving onward?
Just keeping my eye on the prize and my goal was never selfish in nature. It was just, I just wanted people to get better. I wanted more doctors to be able to help more pregnant women. And you can't do that if your ego's in the way.
Nice.
So I had to stop thinking about me and start thinking about what is the greater good here? You know, if somebody doesn't like me, I don't care. I don't know you. It's not, you know, I don't want to create enemies, but if you don't like me and you've never met me, then it seems like the problem is yours, not mine. So, you know, I hope that doesn't sound terrible or conceited, but you just can't worry so much about what people think. And I think that comes with age because 20 years ago, I don't think I would have thought that way. I think I would have been very different in how I approach things. But now it's just, life's too short to really give a darn. So, you know, is this going to help me reach my goal? Is this going to help me care for more moms to be and babies? Is this going to help me train more chiropractors to do what I do? And if the answer is no, then I just throw it out. Or I try to.
Yeah. So Paula says, being on QB radar means you're a big deal. Good for you. Absolutely. Yeah.
I wear that as a badge of honor. I really do. My license was under investigation for 6 months. And the attorney general of our state was investigating our practice. And I mean, I had diarrhea over this because it was a big deal. But then I thought, this is kind of cool because, you know, Deepak Chopra and Wayne Dyer and those big guys, Dr. Andrew Weil or Weil, however you pronounce his name, they're also on that list. So I feel like it's an honor and I'm in good company.
Right. I'm a quack. I love it. Absolutely. And, you know, I say that, and those of you who are joining from the Women Chiropractors Facebook page, you got to love you some haters. Like Grant Cardone says, if you got your 10, get you 20. So I'm not on a mission to tick people off. I am on a mission to help chiropractors make a comeback, to ensure that they are living to their optimum potential. And that means you're going to push limits. That means you're going to press on. That means that there is going to be, like, you're going to have your haters, but that's okay. So let's talk about, so one of the questions that was posed, and let's just get it right out there in case this doc is joining us. What modalities for pregnant women do you recommend?
I don't. I don't practice physical therapy. I'm not licensed in my state. I never took any training in PT, so I don't use it. And quite honestly, I've never found the need for it. Only one instance did I have a patient who really needed PT, and that was postpartum, and that's because her pelvic floor was a disaster, and she really needed a specialized pelvic floor physical therapist that dealt with postpartum issues. And even if I did practice PT, that would have been outside of the scope, in my opinion. So I never really used it. So that's how I recommend it. I don't.
Nice. All right. And so we just wanted to get that out there. We wanted you to know we're going to answer all of your questions. So stay tuned. So the next one is, hey, Karen, so what are your top three go-tos for building a pregnancy niche practice?
Well, there's so many. My top three. The first one is really get a good relationship with a midwife or an MD who understands what it is you do. And, you know, then the next question is, well, how do you do that, Dr. Karen? Oh, there's so many ways. The easiest way that I've done it over the years is ask your patients who their OB or midwife is, and then send them a report of what you did on that patient's first visit. And with that report, send a prescription pad, kind of like if you refer to an MRI facility, they have that little checkoff list of, you know, I want a lateral lumbar, whatever that you're asking for, x-rays, MRI, whatever. While you do that with a pregnancy patient, I want you to analyze and treat sciatica, breech baby, transverse baby, headaches, whatever the symptoms are that come up in your practice for pregnant women. And that way it gives them a very simple way to just, here, check off the list, give it to their patient, and then they call you to schedule. The second is just through your patients themselves. If you know what you're doing and they know you know what you're doing, they're going to refer their friends to you. And let's see, number three, oh, which one do I pick third? I would say being, oh, it's so hard. Oh my gosh. I don't know. What do I do? I think the other thing that really built my practice the most in the beginning was a yoga class that I taught when I was pregnant. If you're not pregnant, or you're never going to be in that position. If you're a guy or you're done having kids, obviously that's not an option for you. But offering a yoga class for pregnancy in your practice is a great thing. If you don't teach it, have someone who is skilled in prenatal care to teach it. And that gives people an opportunity to see your practice, to see pictures of pregnant women all over the place. And they get the idea, even if you're not there, that this is a place for pregnant women. And that silently builds your practice, and you don't even have to try so hard. So those are three.
So, and Paula, just a second, and we'll get to that. I also think I was just talking to Tristan Schaub from Kairo Sushi this morning about that. If you're not registered for Kairo Sushi Summit, please contact me. It's a great time to be together with other female chiropractors. We've got some fun things planned as well. If you are looking for an associate or are looking for an associate or independent contractor's position, I'm hosting a special event for all of you to, as Tim Schaub says, matchmaker, make me a match. For that, to try and connect great doctors and those, whether you're a student or someone who, you know, just you want to be an associate, which I think is a great time to learn. So at any rate, please do that. We were talking about, you know, like one of the best ways in order for you to have research on what you're doing is to serve lots of people. So I know Karen and I were talking, I think it was even just last week, about you have pregnant mamas who are driving an hour and a half, 2 hours mm-hmm. to your practice to get adjusted. I'm guessing it wasn't because they saw an ad, which I know you don't even run ads, but it was because of the relationships and the awesome care that you've delivered. So let's talk for a minute about what are the fundamental things that you look for when caring for a pregnant mama versus a person who's not pregnant. What are those differences? And then Paula, we're going to get to your comment there in just a second.
You mean difference in their physical makeup or their symptom? What do you mean by the differences, Barb?
So what are the major things that are going to be different when looking at and evaluating? Because I know those were some of the things that that people struggle with, even like what you're talking about when you're a student, like my first patient in clinic was pregnant. And what do you do? Like, how do you start your evaluation, and how important is it to be trained specifically to evaluate a pregnant body versus, you know, non?
Right, right. Well, the first thing I think is to look at the structure of the pelvis and the cranium. Everybody, not everybody, a lot of doctors don't think about the cranium as being kind of a mirror image to the pelvis, and especially the TMJ. And this is something that I have added to my technique that I go into great detail over in my newest book, and then also in some of the courses that I teach online. I look at function first. I look at structure first, because when you have a sound structure, then all the nerves work better, and then you can train your patients about subluxation and nerve interference and dis-ease and those things. But first and foremost, I think it's important to focus on the biomechanics of the pregnant pelvis. And consequently, that's a really important thing to nail down, so that when you talk to a midwife or an OBGYN about chiropractic, you talk about the biomechanics, because they're going to understand a distorted pelvic opening is not going to allow for a vaginal delivery. Or if the baby's stuck on the innominate process because, you know, the ilium is rotated internally or the sacrum is rotated laterally or whatever's going on, they can visualize this distortion and they can get it. So biomechanics is paramount. I'm all about balance. So pelvic balance, TMJ balance, cranial balance. And if you don't do all of those, focus on pelvis and then refer out for somebody to look at the TMJ and the cranium too. It can't be ignored, in my opinion. It just can't. Hey, and the front of the pelvis too. Don't ignore the front of the pelvis.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. When you talk to OBs or midwives or doulas, what do you find they don't understand about what we do that then makes them like realize there's a gap in what they can do and how they can help a pregnant mom have a healthy and safe pregnancy and delivery? Like, you know, I didn't adjust a lot of pregnant women, to be honest. Like, it kind of scared me because I didn't know, and that wasn't like, that wasn't my focus even a little bit.
Yeah.
But in the niches I was in, I knew that there were gaps that other healthcare professionals didn't know. So what are those gaps that you have found where when you're talking to them, they're like, oh my gosh, like you're the person who can help? Because I think OBs, midwives, doulas, they all want their mamas to have healthy, safe pregnancies and deliveries. Mm-hmm. And we all know our limitations. Like, I don't care what it is, there are limitations. And that's why it's best to have an attitude of wanting to work with other healthcare professionals than to hate them, in my opinion.
Right.
So what are those gaps?
I think I learned this very early on when I started teaching prenatal chiropractic to midwives and doulas and OBGYNs. I've been invited to go to the University of Pennsylvania School of Nursing and teach them. I taught at the American Association of Birthing Centers several times. I've been a guest speaker at Midwifery Today magazine. I've been, you know, so I've taught the birth professionals what I do. And I learned the hard way that you've got to talk about symptoms with the medical profession. That's something we as chiropractors don't like to do. We talk about symptoms or absence of symptoms does not mean health. Got it. We're not teaching them about subluxation or presence or absence of subluxation, subluxation removal. We're not teaching them that. We want them to refer to us. What do they focus on? Symptoms. What do you have to meet them? Where do you have to meet them? Symptom-based care. Doctor, OBGYN, what do you do with patients with sciatica? There's nothing. They can't do anything. Well, a chiropractor can do boom, 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 boom.
Yeah.
And that's why they refer to you.
That's
why they refer. Yeah. You've got to focus on symptoms if you're going to get through to your audience, which is that medical model. The medical model is symptom-based. Yes. When those patients are in your office, you don't have to be symptom-based anymore. You can talk about the power that made the body heals the body and all the wonderful things that chiropractic is. But to get other professionals to understand why your niche is so important and really the only one that can help their patients, in my opinion, you have to hit them with the symptoms. You have to.
Yeah. And I think you bring up a really good point too. It's kind of like when they're presented with, let's say, a breech, because we're going to get to the Gardner method in just a second, a breech baby or, you know, migraines or whatever it is. I honestly think that the majority of them know that giving their mamas a drug isn't a good thing for mama or baby. But what else are they supposed to do if they look in their bag of tricks? All I have is this. Well, that's where, when we build those relationships with the OBs and the doulas and the midwives, and we let them know, like, here's how I can help. This is what I'm a special, you know, like, this is my specialty. This is how I can come alongside you and really help you ensure that this mama has, you know, a safe pregnancy and a healthy delivery. And remember that there's a reason that OBs have such a gigantic malpractice rate. And that is because a lot of mamas and babies get injured, unfortunately, during delivery. So if you can help them build a bridge over fearful parts of their practice, I promise you, they're going to refer. And Karen, in your, at Preg Cairo, and all of you watching, I'll put a new one up there, but it's got to be www.pregcairo.com. So if you're just going to pregcairo.com and it's not working, you got to throw in three W's. So at any rate, when in teaching doctors at Preg Cairo or where you're doing for CE hours, and for those of you who don't know, you can get CE hours through chirocredit.com. Look up Dr. Karen Gardner Richter, and then pregnancy. So the cool thing is you can actually get your continuing education hours and things that are going to build your practice, which, woohoo, instead of just like jurisprudence or whatever. So check
and
out.
Actually, leave off Richter. Professionally, I'm just Dr. Karen Gardner. So that's what you'll look up on ChiroCredit.
Okay. So Dr. Karen Gardner. And so at ChiroCredit, she has, you know, like, basic training. If you want real in-depth training, go to pregcairo.com. At pregcairo.com, Karen, do you teach doctors also how do they build those relationships with the midwives and the doulas and all of that?
Absolutely. I've got over 15 modules that I'm working to revamp. I taught this technique years ago with my old identity, and I'm redoing it now. I've improved the courses. I've added more information. I've added two more classes, one on essential oils during pregnancy that was not available before. Essential oils, everybody's using them. Nobody knows if this is safe for pregnancy or not or whatever. So I'm doing a whole new class on that, and I'm also doing a major class on marketing. So you're going to have the skills to care for pregnant women. But to me, that's not enough. You have to know how to drive those pregnant women to your offices, how to get other people to refer to your practice so that you can care for the needs of these women. Mm-hmm. So yes, I do go into a lot of detail. And there's a class on there right now, the easy way to grow your pregnancy practice, I think, is the one that's on there. You can go into that. It gives a ton of detail. And then when I go into more detail in later episodes or modules of my course, you can add to that class. So yes, to answer that question, yes, I do teach people how to get pregnant women into your practice and how to market to other professionals, because I had to do it twice. Once when I started and once when I reinvented myself. So,
what you're saying is you're really good at it.
I am. Yeah.
That's awesome. All right. So I'm going to pop up Dr. Paula's question. Can you see it?
Yes. It says, can you share your prescription pad? I'll see what I can do. I'll put it in one of the free resources on pregcairo.com. I have a lot of resources there, some webinars that are free, a lot of downloads that are free. There's some paid for courses as well. So I'll put it in the downloadable materials. I'm going to write a note so that I can remember to do that. Because, by the way, hanging out with pregnant women all day, I really think baby brain is contagious. Because if I don't write it down, it doesn't happen.
Yeah, that's me. If I showed you my office. I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21 yellow sticky notes right in front of my monitor. So I can definitely appreciate that.
Yeah.
And most of them are like reminders to myself, like this one, it's one of my favorites. Refuse to feed fear with time. Take massive action fast. Dominate. Am I taking 10x action today? So I want to like just like be real honest with everyone watching today as well. If you want to grow your pregnancy practice, you can't do it part-time. And what I mean by part-time is if you're raising a family, like I get it, and your kids are definitely priority, but never give up. So I think there's a consciousness out there that, you know, those who are successful in business, they're lucky. I'll tell you why they're lucky is because they never give up. So if you've contacted an OB before or a doula or a midwife, until and unless you've contacted them eight times in what I would consider a concentrated period, like 2 months, trust me, you haven't contacted them enough. So it used to be between 3 and 5 times were enough, but now with the noise in the market, it's 8 times. And until and unless 10% of your database is saying, leave me alone, like 10% of them says, leave me alone, you're contacting me too much, you're not doing it enough. If you need help in how do I contact them? What do I say? Ask us. We're happy to help you. But the most important thing is you have to, you know, it's just like if a salesperson or somebody came to your office and all they did was try to make contact with you one time, it's easy just to blow that off. But somebody who keeps coming around and saying, hey, I want to work with you. 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 Now you're going to take them more seriously. So if you've been trying to build your pregnancy practice, but you're doing it just kind of like, you know, roll the dice and hope for the best, that has never been a winning strategy to 10x the business. That has never been a winning strategy to take care of your family. I'm telling you the truth.
Yeah.
I also invite you, I'm going to do a plug for my 56-day chiropractic boot camp to double your business. It's intense. It's for chiropractors who want to make a comeback. It's for chiropractors who want to go hard and get the message out there and rapidly grow their practice. I am offering a tremendous discount of $500 off. There's only a limited few that I'm willing to do that for. So message me to grab one of those. The launch date is April 17th. It is going to be intense and you will double your business in 56 days. So if you want to rock it like that, please message me and I'll be happy to give you one of those spots. So let's talk about the Gardner method, please.
Okay. Well, it's everything you could possibly want to know about pregnancy care, but we're afraid to ask. No, it's things that you need to know to care for pregnant women. It's things that you probably didn't even think about caring for the special needs of a pregnant woman in some cases. It's how to deal with the XYZs of everything that comes into your office, from hemorrhoids to breech baby to posterior baby to marketing to, I mean, it's just everything. So it's the whole ball of wax. Is that the right phrase? The whole ball of wax. So what do you want to know? Chances are it's in that whole method. Did that answer your question?
So the Gardner method then has expanded. Because originally, and for those of you who know, and maybe many of you have trained on the Bagnell method, or the Bagnell technique was churning breech babies. It's now called the Gardner method is part of that. So yeah. Let's talk about breech babies, and let's just talk about, let's first talk about what's the difference between what you are teaching and maybe what most people think of the technique in our profession for turning breech babies, and why, what is the other method missing that can really help doctors who are watching today or in the future to help mamas? Because that's honestly, that's all it's about, is to help mamas to make sure that these babies have a healthy delivery.
Well, first of all, I just want to clarify that no chiropractic technique out there turns breech babies. We don't touch the baby. None of us turn them. I don't care what technique you use, what name you give it. If you're turning a breech baby, you're not practicing chiropractic. If you're adjusting the pelvis and the ligaments that attach to the pelvis and the lumbar spine, the thoracic cervical spine, the TMJ, the cranial, whatever it is that you're adjusting and the baby happens to turn as a result of that adjustment, that's chiropractic. I just want to be clear about that. And docs, if you ever give a talk about breech babies and chiropractic, please be very clear in your vernacular that you're not saying I'm turning breech babies or, you know, this technique turns baby. No. Just steer clear of that, first of all. Secondly, the technique that I do focuses on the whole entire pelvis, the front of the pelvis, the back of the pelvis, the ligaments that attach to the pelvis, the ligaments that attach to the uterus. There are so many ligaments that attach the uterus to the inside of the pelvis. I can't even go over them all. So you think about just one ligament, the uterosacral ligament. Where do you think it goes? Uterosacral. Uterus to sacrum. Yeah. So if the sacrum is misaligned, and in my opinion, the sacrum rotates, the apex rotates versus other techniques that say it moves posteriorly on one side. My experience over the past 24 years of doing this tells me that the baby will, I'm sorry, that the mom's sacrum rotates, the apex rotates either to the left or the right. With that comes instability in the SI joint. Also, the pubic bone can't be ignored. I've been adjusting the pubic bone since 1991. And I've been telling people since 1991, you have to adjust the pubic bone if you want to affect the pelvis in a pregnant woman, especially. I also look at the TMJ, the alignment of the TMJ. And SOT, the jaw, mirror images the pelvis. This is a pelvis. So if this is misaligned and it's causing misalignment in the pelvis, adjusting the pelvis isn't going to correct the primary cause. So you have to look for primary cause versus secondary cause. The right. cranium goes along with that. You can't adjust the TMJ and not affect the temporal bone, the parietal bone, the sphenoid, the frontal. You know, it's all connected. So my technique looks at all of that. So there you go.
Awesome. And so I remember you and I had a conversation the other day with a mama who came in and was breech, and she was like, oh, well, I gotta go to my, and basically she was choosing between coming to your office and going to a nurse midwifery appointment. And right. you basically just told her, all right, let's get real here.
Yeah.
What happened? And how do you do that? Like, how do you have the,
breast ovaries?
Yeah. And how can women grow their confidence in telling a mama, like, listen, I'm not claiming to change the presentation of your baby from breech to head down. I'm not claiming to do that. And thanks for that correction. Instead, my intention is to ensure that your body is in the best position, the best balance for your baby to do what your body was naturally designed to do. And that's to have a vaginal birth. How can a doctor who's watching this now or later grow that confidence? My answer is it's practice. It's like, you yeah. know, how do you get better at you practice, but,
right.
but what advice do you have?
I think your self-esteem rises when your skill gets better. So if you know that you've done this a zillion times and this is the outcome, then that helps your self-esteem and that helps you be more direct. But I think for somebody who may not have the experience, just believe in what you're doing. Believe that it works, whether you believe it or not. It does work.
That's right.
Believe in what your goal is. Is your goal to be right, or is your goal to help that mom have an increased chance of a vaginal birth? And if you come from that, I think you come from a place of love and caring, and then you can be more direct. Like this lady said that she couldn't come in on a time that I had available for her because she had a midwifery appointment. And she told me that that was more important. And I said, oh, really? Is she going to get your baby to turn with chiropractic care? Is your baby going to turn in the midwife's office or in the chiropractor's office? And she goes, oh, you're right. I'm going to change my midwife appointment. And she did. And she came in and guess what? Baby's head down. So it was a good call on her part. But if I had let that go, I don't know that she would have really had the chance to get that baby to turn itself head down so that she could have a vaginal birth. And she's due next week. And I think she's coming in tomorrow, actually. So, yeah, you just have to take a step back and say, it's not about your ego. It's about helping that mom. And on the other coin, you can't force them to want what you have to offer either. If they really believe going to the midwife is more important, then that's their priority. And that's okay.
That's right.
But you tried.
Care, don't carry, and never
that's
chase.
Right. Never and, chase.
And I, you know, I want to say this too, that, you know, those of us who do speak out in confidence, all we know is I know that if you're subluxated, there is no way that Dr. McCare just posted something and I'm going to make a comment on it. There's no way that you can be as healthy as possible if you're subluxated. Whether or not you get better from your symptoms, I am 100% confident that subluxation will rob you of optimum potential. Whether that means your baby is head down, whether that means you have a healthy delivery, whether that means that you recover from an illness, whether that means you're symptomatic or not. If you are subluxated, you will not be at your optimum potential, plain and simple. Right. Does that mean you'll never have a problem? No. I mean, and doctors, please don't chase after the magic bullet. It doesn't exist. And I'll tell you, like, I used to say this honestly and truly when any time in my practice, even with new practice members, if they asked for the magic bullet, I told them this. Here's the deal. No magic bullet has ever existed for anything in life, whether it's marriage, raising kids, health, fitness, money. There isn't a magic bullet. But here's the deal. I'm a phenomenal businesswoman. And if you ever find the magic bullet for anything, I don't care what it is, even if you're not a member of my practice, you remember, you get in touch with me, we'll market it together and make millions and change people's lives, because so far the magic bullet has not happened. So please make sure that we don't put that much pressure on innate to heal spontaneously. No one got there overnight and they're not going to recover overnight. So be honest and tell them it's going to take time, but the only way that you for sure will not get there is if you never get started. So remain mm-hmm. consistent, and I promise your body will do what it was designed to do when it can clear the interference that's there. So Dr. McCare said, believe that chiropractic is the only option for resolving in utero constraint. Yeah, so let's talk about that for a minute. Hey, Dr. McCare, love ya. Let's talk for a second about what does the medical profession have for utero constraint? And can that be a really great launch pad then in conversations with OBs and the like?
No. I don't think it's a great launch pad because I don't think that they look at that as an issue. They have, the baby's breech, their solution, C-section. Do you know why it's their solution? Because they do not teach how to deliver breech babies in medical schools anymore. That is the proper protocol for delivering a breech baby is a cesarean section. End of story, no comment. Always. In the States, I don't know about other countries. I know in the States that's the case. And midwives are veering away. It's a shame. So midwives are also veering away from that. Even though they have the training, they don't have a medical doctor to back them up. So again, breech baby means a C-section. So in utero constraint is really, I believe it's a technical term that we use in chiropractic, to explain why the baby might not be turning. There's other things, docs, by the way, that can keep that baby from turning, and it has nothing to do with constraint. It can be absolutely like a fibroid, a uterine fibroid that's in there, and your hands are tied too. I mean, I've had patients with babies that were breached. They had a uterine fibroid. I adjusted the mom, the baby went head down, and then they popped back breech again, then head down the next time and popped up breech again. And the reason was the baby's face was right in the fibroid and they didn't like it. So they kept turning back breech again. C-section was the only option for that mom. I've had other pregnant women who've had bicornuate uterus where their uterus is shaped like a heart and the baby is stuck up in here in a breech position and they got to get head down. And I mean, there's other reasons besides in utero constraint that I talk about too in my training and what you can do about each of those. And breech baby is not the only thing to be concerned with. I've actually talked to innumerable doctors who said to me, well, as long as the baby's head down, that's fine, right? Nope, that's not fine. If the baby's occiput is pressing on the mom's sacrum, that's called occiput posterior or posterior occiput. They call it OP in the lingo. That's not good because it usually leads to cesarean section because mom does not progress for a variety of reasons. She doesn't progress. So there's a specific thing that I do during pregnancy. If the midwife lets me know the baby is OP, I know exactly what I need to look for. It has to do with some cranial involvement, and I adjust the mom and the baby's flip. They do a circle. They don't flip this way. They go this way and they get their occiput anterior, and then labor is much more easy for mom, and chance of a cesarean section goes down. It's never ever eliminated, but it goes down.
So Karen,
yeah.
Let's talk for a second about pregnant mamas that you're caring for, in obviously while they're pregnant and now they're in labor.
Yeah.
Do a lot of them call you? What happens? Like the first time you ever adjusted a mama in pregnancy, can you give some tips of how to care for mom while she's laboring?
For several years, my practice was, I had two locations. One was inside of a birthing center. So if a mom came and she was my patient and she was laboring in the birthing center, I would also adjust her. And the best way to do that is get in there quick between contractions and be patient because, you know, sometimes they come very quickly. So, you know, don't adjust mom while she's having a contraction. That would be my first tip. The other thing is definitely check with your malpractice insurance because, and I'm sad to say this, I hate it, but it's very true. We live in a very litigious society, and if your malpractice insurance doesn't cover you in the labor room, then don't do it. I've coached many women and men who care for pregnant women. And one of my coaching clients in particular was in a birthing center adjusting her own patient. The baby died and she was being sued because she was in the room during delivery. In fact, everyone who's in the room during delivery is always named in the lawsuit. Whether or not you're directly responsible doesn't matter. You're always involved in the lawsuit. So I choose not to adjust women in labor any longer. Number one, it always happens at 3 a.m. I don't want to get up. I'm so cozy in my bed. I don't want to get up. That's why I'm not a midwife, because I could never do that. But if they do come to me on their way to the birth center, or if that so happens, then, you know, yes, I do adjust women in my own office, but I don't attend the birth anymore. And that's just my personal choice. I'm getting old. I don't want to get up at 3 a.m. anymore, but other doctors do. But I do recommend definitely that you check with your malpractice insurance to make sure that it's okay. God forbid the worst happens, that you're covered for that. That would be my legal advice on that one.
Okay. And so something that you do and that you have always focused on, different than a lot of other pregnancy techniques, is anterior, is looking at the pubic bone. Mm-hmm. What can you give just a little bit about that? And then I want to jump to the pregnancy Merrick chart, and then we'll be signing off because we're already at 45 minutes. So let's talk first about the pubic bone and then the pregnancy Merrick chart.
Well, pubic bone plays a huge role because of its attachment to the uterus and other ligaments that support the pelvis, like the round ligament. You can manipulate, I say manipulate like this, manipulate the round ligament as much as you want. But if that pubic bone is superior, it's going to cause that round ligament to be in spasm again, or the other side to be in spasm. It depends on the individual. So I've always been the kind of person that wants to know why is the round ligament in spasm, and what's causing that, and what's causing that, and what's causing that. So I look at the most primary part of it, and to me it's been the pubic bone. So that affects alignment of the pelvis, it affects alignment of the sacrum, it affects alignment of the frontal bone. The Lovett brother in SOT is the frontal bone to the pubic bone. So that's why I do cranial work. I mean, it's all tied together. So that's why I look at the front of the pelvis. I think it's very overlooked.
Hey, Karen, what do you find happens with docs that you've coached and you've helped who in caring for a pregnant mom, they forget about the cranium.
Well,
are adjustments not holding, or what's true?
Well, adjustments don't hold if the spine and the pelvis are misaligned secondarily to the cranial misalignments. If you never adjust the primary issue, the secondary issues are always going to show up. So if you have recurring subluxation pattern that just isn't clearing, check cranial, especially TMJ. And usually I'll get an email, Dr. Karen, I don't know what the heck I'm doing wrong. This patient, blah, 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 breach. I adjusted this. I had checked the pubic bone. Did you check the TMJ? Oh, I forgot the TMJ. So then they go back and they do that. And then whammo, baby does its somersault, and the baby flips head down or anterior or whatever the case may be. And then we found out what the primary subluxation pattern was.
And do you, in your materials, do you have a, like kind of a checklist if this, and I know that it's like rarely linear, but at least it's a place to start. Like for instance, if you're finding this presentation, then make sure you're checking blah, 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 blah. If you find this presentation, yeah. Make sure you check yada, yada, yada.
I do that. And I do that, for instance, with morning sickness too. Like, you know, for a normal symptom that women typically have during pregnancy, morning sickness. Okay, check this area for subluxation. Check this area for subluxation. Recommend this remedy or that herb or whatever. And even if you don't recommend herbs and homeopathy or essential oils in your practice, I guarantee you, your patients are looking into that. And they're going to ask you for advice because they see you a lot more frequently than they see their caregiver, especially during the beginning of pregnancy. They're only going there once a month. They could be seeing you 2-3 times a week. That's so right. Even if your practice doesn't include those adjunctive therapies or products, I really encourage you to understand them so that you can better educate your patients and yeah. guide them into making a better and more researched decision. Because not everything out there is safe just because you can buy it on Amazon, I got to tell you. Seriously.
And you know, that's definitely my philosophy about offering supplements or other things in your practice. Either have it and then obviously have back-end sales and make it as a convenience to your practice members, or oils, and be knowledgeable about it. Because here's the deal. Your practice members, like Dr. Karen said, are seeing it. They are hearing about it. They see it on TV, or they see it on Facebook, or they see it, you know, their friends talk about it. And so they typically are going to run out and buy something, and then they don't really know what the proper use is. Or they hear, oh, vitamin D is really important, so they go buy the jar that's this big at Sam's Club that they almost have to have a front-end loader to get into their vehicle. Meanwhile, that's creating more chemical stress, and now they're showing up in your office, and they've got, you know, thoracic spine subluxations that absolutely won't clear up, and it never dawns on me, like, oh, duh, chemical stress. Right. So I am definitely a big believer, and I'm not saying you have to be all things to all people. So if you're hearing that, those words didn't come out of my mouth. I'm simply suggesting that it's important as healthcare professionals, especially in the natural health field, that we're aware of what are the trends and to be able to give advice to your practice members about them. But if you don't know, don't guess. Tell them, you know, that's a great question. I don't know, but I want to find out. I'll get back to you on Friday. And then make sure you do it. And it's a great excuse to be in touch with your practice members. Please be listening to me on this. Knowing the trends is a great reason to send email newsletters. Is a great reason to do Facebook Lives. It's a great reason to do strategies for healthy living workshops in your office. It's a great reason to just like remember eight times with your message. All right. So thank you for that, Paula. She said, ha, 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 about the front end loader. So, Paula, you bring up something funny. So I remember my coach, Dr. Tony, saying to me, like, why are you always pissing people off when I was in practice? Because I was just like balls to the wall. And there were so many times, and I'm sorry, Samson and Micah, those are my children, that I put you through this, that I would be at a store and someone would have like all these bottles of whether, I don't know, some kind of OTC in their cart. And I'd be like, what's your chiropractor say about that? And they'd look at me like, weirdo. And I'd be like, yeah, what's your chiropractor say about you taking that kind of stuff? And they'd be like, what do you mean chiropractor? I'm like, oh, you don't have a chiropractor? Are you kidding me? Like, weird.
What's wrong with you?
Yeah, that you don't have a chiropractor. And sometimes it would get like, you know, like security calls. Not really. It never went quite that far. But many times it did lead to me throwing on my business card. I figured if I was at Sam's, I might as well turn it into a marketing event. And so I did it. I don't know. Dumb and stupid, I guess. But I'm still stupid and still spreading the chiropractic message. So let's talk real quickly about Merrick chart and then we'll jump off. The pregnancy Merrick chart.
Yeah. What about it?
let's talk about it. Like, what's different? What if I just use a regular Merrick chart? Is that good enough?
Yeah, it's good enough. Absolutely. If you want to identify yourself as a pregnancy expert, why not have pregnancy materials available to your patients? I have a regular Merrick chart that I give to my non-pregnant patients. I have a pediatric Merrick chart that I give to my pediatric cases. I give it to the parents because the kids will like color on it or something. And then for pregnant women, I have the pregnancy chart. And the difference is, you know, when L3 is subluxated, I don't just talk about knee pain. I say maybe breech baby or I can't even think now what's on there. Breech baby, preterm labor, hormonal changes, things like that. C2, breech baby. Believe it or not, there's a huge component to C2 and a breech baby that a lot of other techniques kind of overlook a little bit, but there's a huge correlation between C2 and breech baby. And I believe it has to do with the attachment of the dura to the sacrum and C2 and occiput. But anyway, so T6, instead of just stomach complaints, it's written on there, nausea, morning sickness, heartburn. Like the symptoms that a pregnant woman is going to experience during pregnancy that can be traced back to subluxation in the spine, that's what's on the chart. And that's why I have it. I have a poster in my office and then I hand out on the patient's first visit, I circle what I found during their exam. Here you go. This is what's going on. Oh, you didn't tell me that hemorrhoids can be traced back to the spine. I'm like, yeah. You want to talk about that? And most people don't bring it up on their own, but that's one that, you know, if it comes up, bring it up because there are things that you can do to help that mom today to make her more comfortable. So there you go.
And I love that. So Dr. Karen just inadvertently, I know that she didn't do it on purpose, showed you the exact way to use a pregnancy Merrick chart. You don't have to memorize it. Have it, it's right behind her in her office. Like that's her adjusting room. Have like stuff all over your practice that you regularly refer to, because you know what? You're teaching your practice members how to refer, right? By going to the Merrick chart and saying like, oh, okay, so let's check this out. You're also teaching them how to answer their questions, but through a chiropractic context, through the nerve system, through the spine. Like my office, I had Merrick charts everywhere and I always grab them and refer to them. And then I'd be like, hey, do you want a copy? Like this will help you and please, you know, put a copy in your car, put a copy in your desk, put a copy everywhere because your friends and family members are going to see how healthy you are and you'll be able to show them how they can get the help that they need too. It's through their spine and the nerve system at my office because I am the best chiropractor for them. Yes, you have to be your biggest fan. So Dr. Karen has that pregnancy chart right behind her. And I know that she walks over there with her practice members and says, all right, so you know how you're having heartburn? Well, on this Merrick chart, you can see that these nerves come out of the spine right here. Your spine has changed. And I don't have to tell you that, you know, Mrs. Pregnant Woman. Your spine has changed because you're pregnant. That puts different strains on your spine and on your nervous system. These nerves go to these tissues. When there's subluxation at these tissues, here are the symptoms that are common. Now, I also found in your evaluation today that, you know what, T12, it's jacked up. Now, the cool thing is that you're getting adjusted today so you don't have to suffer from X, Y, and Z. So when you do find subluxation on your evaluation, I encourage all of you to show them and to compliment them and say, hey, the cool thing is you got adjusted. You didn't even know you were subluxated in those areas, but because you got adjusted, now you don't have to deal with that. Congratulations. And that's the best reason why individuals seek regular chiropractic care instead of symptomatic relief is to always stay ahead so their body can be well. So their body has the energy, the nerve flow, the the mental impulses from the brain to all their cells and tissues in order to dissolve, in order to neutralize, in order to adapt to problems before they affect your quality of life. Whew! That was a long one.
One of my favorite things, that a lot of my patients come in and they'll say, well, what did you find today, Dr. Karen? I said, well, I found this, this, and this. Well, what does that one go to? I'm like, well, that goes to your gallbladder. I knew it. I had a gallbladder attack last night, and yeah. I knew you were going to find that. So they're testing me, and it's fun. And I love that they're getting that their symptomatology is related to their spine. And they also know that, oh, I'm so glad you adjusted that because I don't want another gallbladder attack. Like, they get the opposite effect of that as well. So when you use the Merrick system, the Merrick chart, whatever you want to call it, and you focus on that during your table talk, people get that their spine is the key to their health. It's amazing how they do that. It's amazing. I love it.
All right. So we've got one more quick question here. Yeah. Dr. Paula said, I'm a Gonstead trained practitioner. Can I easily implement info from Merrick into my practice? I do TMJ work all day long.
Well, Gonstead has a whole Merrick chart all of his own. I studied that quite a bit in chiropractic school. It's a little bit different than the Merrick system, based on sympathetics and parasympathetics and things like that. But I mean, if you want to use that chart to talk to your patients about their symptoms and their subluxation patterns, then use that. If you want to use the Merrick system, use that. I mean, it's really your comfort at this level, doc. What makes you feel like you have the most confidence? That's where it comes into play. And yeah, TMJ is killer. Good for you.
All right, so one last thing. We might as well like cruise it right on up to 60 minutes. Tell me about this ebook that you got going.
Oh yeah. So back when the Quackbusters first decided I was a target, I decided my coach told me, take the target off your back and put it on your front. So
Who was that told you to do that?
It wasn't you. it was Tony Palermo.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I don't think he was my coach at that point. He was just a mentor of mine. And he encouraged me to take the target off my back and put it on my front. And then I had to figure out what that meant. So I said, you know, I think I'm going to train more doctors to do what I do so that they can't come after all of us. And then I wrote my first book, and I've since converted that book to ebook, and it's available on Kindle or iTunes or whatever mode that you want to look at it. And I'm converting my other book, the Breach Technique book, to Kindle as well. That's a little bit slower going because I have a lot of other irons on the fire. But this book is basic prenatal care from, you know, the first visit to postpartum visits to herbs and homeopathy during pregnancy, lots of pictures, a little bit about the technique is in there, and you can get it at pregchiro.com or pregnancychiropractic.com. That's the other website that I have. I have an online store there. And if you do want to purchase the book, it's not on Amazon, so you can't directly download it to your Kindle. You have to download it to your computer first and then send it to your Kindle. It's one extra step, but it saves a lot of Amazon has a big fee. So I'm trying to keep my fees low. So I'm avoiding Amazon for the time being. We'll see what happens in the future. But so download it to your computer and then you can send it to your Kindle device. I have directions on how to do that and links and all that jazz to make it super easy. And if you want that, because you're watching this Facebook Live with the famous Dr. Barbara, you can use the coupon code FBOOKLIVE20 and you'll save 20%. So it's a no-brainer, really. And you can get it today and start reading it and use the information tomorrow.
Awesome.
Or later today.
Awesome. Love it. Hey, thanks so much, everyone. So we came in at 58 minutes. Woo! So we really appreciate you hanging out with us. And if you have questions or like me, you want to have Dr. Karen on again and dive in even deeper to pregnancy care, I think it's just like so important because who doesn't want to have a healthy pregnancy? Everybody does. But there's
exactly.
Like so much misinformation out there that it's important for us to quack bust it. So at any rate, thank you so much. God bless you all. Have a wonderful, wonderful rest of your week. Just so you know, on tap, next Wednesday, Keith, actually, you're pretty much are a doctor. Keith Wasung will be with me next Wednesday at 1 p.m.
Love and his stuff. He's great.
Yeah, absolutely. And then Dr. Kellyanne Petrucci herself, the bone broth lady, will be with me on the 30th at 7 p.m. Eastern. So super excited about that. And I have just an amazing lineup of guests for April. So make sure that you're watching my page so that you can join us, and really appreciate you being here. Thanks, Karen. Love you.
Love you too. Bye.
See ya. Bye.